Princeton, Jamaica, Bob Marley. Come on!
When Marley starts to sing, it's something like outer space.
It was just his energy on stage. It was electric.
He just blew the roof off with positive vibration and some positive reggae music.
For a lot of people, it was kind of seen the Messiah.
In the 1970s, Bob Marley rose from humble beginnings to become a global superstar.
Anywhere you go in the world, people know Bob Marley.
It was a journey that took place not just in his homeland of Jamaica, but also in the country he came to regard. As his second home.
Everything started right here in England.
Britain set the platform from which he launched his international career. If this didn't happen, we would not have the Bob Marley we know today.
Along the way, Marley left an indelible mark on Great Britain.
So we're pissed off and angry, and Bob gave that a soundtrack.
This is the story of Bob Marley's time in Britain and how he changed the lives of the people he met here.
You still go back and talk about Bob Marley came to our school. The excitement is still there.
We never realized we was in the presence of someone who would transcend worldwide.
Bob looked back and said, "You ready, Dennis?" I went, "Yeah." And the adventure began.
'72, a year of national crisis in the UK. Violence in Northern Ireland, mass picketing, and more than a million unemployed.
It's hard for people to understand what a dump much of Britain was in the first half of the 70s. You know, it still looks like the remnants of World War II. You know, I mean, there's still bomb site damage.
The social and political and economic climate of the time was crap for everybody. If you were black, multiply that by 10.
Britain was very, for me, very quite a hostile place growing up. Here in these, we felt we could. Even leave our communities because people would, the racial attacks at the time, and just the slogans on the walls. And we were only young children, and so I think it quite traumatized us, and I think the atmosphere was very much that we weren't wanted.
Young black people called the police the Wicked Babylon, and they felt they were being persecuted.
We were treated like shit back in those days. And we were desperate for something that would lift us up.
In 1972, Bob Marley arrived in Britain as part of a tour he hoped would launch his international career.
Bob Marley had already had a career in Jamaica. which my parents had embraced. By the time he's arriving, or we are aware of him as first generation Black British born individuals, he's in what I would call second phase of a career. Marley was collaborating with Johnny Nash at the time, and Johnny Nash had already had hits in the States. So Marley came over as part of the Johnny Nash tour.
But while Marley saw the Nash tour as a chance to find an audience outside Jamaica, his band, the Wailers, were less enthusiastic.
So there's tensions in the band as to why go into Babylon, the UK, the mother of the colonial experience that had been suppressing them forever. Why are we doing that? Bob Marley wanted to go out, wanted to challenge the world, if you like, with his message.
London soon became like a second home to Marley, living in rented flats in Camden and Bayswater. Yes, my friend. He found himself mixing with some of the rising stars of Britain's own reggae scene, including Brinsley Ford, who later formed Aswad, and Loxley Gishi, lead guitarist in the Cimarrons.
Control me now. Bad tune.
Bad tune, man. You can tune this. This tune is like a, you know, keep it down.
So when Bob come first, right? Bob wasn't even rusted at them time,
no,
was he?
No, no, big afro.
Yeah. And he used to wear it in plaits, so you see the bend and kick up.
Yeah, soul rebel. Yeah. Soul rebel. I'm a rebel. Soul rebel. So Bob said to us, I'm looking for a band to do some gigs around London. If we could do it. I said, of course, man, no problem with that, you know? And the first gig we did, it was alongside John Nash. We were together at the Apollo Club, Middleton. Yeah, you couldn't believe it.
This is the club where you
yeah,
played?
The Apollo,
London Apollo.
That's Apollo Club right here.
And it's still there. Yeah. It's still got the sign, everything.
Yeah. By the summer of 72, Marley had been joined in London by the rest of the Wailers.
Day's done. Now I'll be sorry that you breezed in.
The band set up base in this quiet North London suburb.
The illuminated signs all say welcome to the borough that everybody's pleased in. Neasden.
Neasden was really a quiet, I wouldn't say gentrified, but it was an up-and-coming quiet town. In 1972, I started to work at the Co-op in Neasden Lane. So I remember one afternoon, this person walked towards me in had a berry. And as he came nearer to me, I mean, it's silly now, but I asked him the question. I said, but you're Peter Tosh. And he just nodded and he went on. So I remember speaking to a good friend of mine, Delroy Washington. And he said to me, yeah, the Wailers, they're actually living not far from here, just around the corner. So I went with him that evening after finishing work, and sure enough, at the Circle, there was Bob Marley, Peter Tosh, Bonnie Wailer. It was just like I was in a dream. Here we are in the Circle. We're coming to it. This is the house where Bob Marley stayed.
Yeah, it's right here on the left.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. Look at it. this is the house.
Yeah.
Remember stuff from, remember come back now.
She gonna take a look?
Yeah.
This wasn't like this.
No.
This wasn't like this. And the door was different.
Yeah, it was all different, yeah. And there's a back garden around there. At the back, remember the back garden? Yeah.
I don't remember the back garden too much.
Garden around there, yeah.
So when Bob them came here, to the people of the area, was like, what is going on?
Yeah, they didn't know what's happening,
In Bob and Bunny, they would walk as a group. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just looked like the picture on Catch a Fire. You'd see them walking up the main street.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be like watching the Beatles now walk up a main street. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? It was still different. There was an atmosphere, there was an aura about them. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. For me, being big fans of the Wailers, it was like, this is not real. It's not real. Yeah, yeah. we were in there one night jamming. Mm-hmm. And Bob said, give me that guitar there. Mm-hmm. And he sat on the bed and started strumming a tune.
Yes.
And I always remember it as being, we don't need no more trouble. Mm-hmm. We don't need no
trouble. Bob was really, very... I was thinking, he's a man, he's a thinking man. Sometimes he go very quiet, isn't he? Sometimes he go very, very quiet. And sometimes he'd be just loud.
We never realized we was in the presence of someone who would transcend worldwide.
Yeah, and good memories. You know, very, very good memories.
But in 1972, Bob Marley was still far from a household name and had to seek unexpected avenues in his attempts to reach a wider audience.
In 1972, Bob goes to Ronnie Scott's and he just starts talking to someone who's there, who's a teacher. And he's sort of saying, well, I can't get anything going here. You know, it doesn't seem to be happening. The guy says, I'll come and play at our school to our kids, you know, in Peckham. It's absolutely your sort of target area. So he does, and it was kind of a legendary show.
The school I went to was called Peckham Manor. It's been renamed the Damilola Taylor Centre. One day, our art teacher, Mr. Keith Both, came in.
Morning.
Said to us, boys, I've got a great surprise for you guys. Johnny Nash and Bob Marley coming in to do a session in our technical wing. Most of us West Indian boys used to listen to Bob Marley more so than Johnny Nash. There are a couple of lads, I understand, that will be coming down to the centre today who were here at that time. Be interesting to catch up and see how we've all changed after all that time. Hello, mate.
Hello. Tony Hagen.
I'm George Dyer.
Nice to see you. I swear these are the same benches we probably sat on the day.
This face looks familiar. Hello, Bev.
Yeah, you do. How
are you? How are you guys?
I'm good. Come here.
You all right? Yeah,
it's been a long time.
March 72, yeah.
God, it's unbelievable. Yeah. You know, when I saw the photograph of all of us as young men, and I thought, don't we look so different?
Definitely
that, yeah. There was a little round stage there, and what it was, we all sat around. Yeah. There was people on the outside, both sides, but most of us was actually focused at the front here.
Curved round, you know? Wasn't it?
Yeah. Spirit up, little
darling, stir it up. You have that? Do you remember the songs Bob and Johnny sung? One was definitely Steer It Up.
I remember the Steer It Up, but I can't remember the second song.
I think I Can See Clearly Now was the second song, so that's the one I went out and bought.
I can see clearly now, the rain is gone. I can see all obstacles in my way.
For me, it was just something extraordinary because I never thought someone that famous would have actually come to our school because everyone avoided the school. Everyone thought we were... that's somewhere that no one wants to be.
We used to call the school Peckham Madhouse.
So the concert ended. It was the end of the school day, so we went out into the playground and just had a kick around because it was nearly time to go home.
And this was the tarmac playground.
It would have been around here though, wouldn't it?
They walked out from, I think, either one of the... Yeah. Either there, and they walked along towards us.
I've been telling people for years that I play football with Johnny Nash and Bob Marley, and no one ever believed me. Then a few years ago, the photos surfaced. Yeah, well, that's definitely me there at the front.
No.
You're not there. Where are you? Where are you?
I'm standing back. I'm out of shot.
That's myself with the actual football, trying to play to keep me up with
with Bob Marley having a look. And Johnny...
I won't forget that smile, mate.
I think some of the excitement you feel when you still go back and talk about Bob Marley and Johnny Nash came to our school, that still excitement is still there. As young kids, we were so sort of jolly about it.
For George Dyer, now a bespoke tailor, meeting Bob Marley was a life-changing moment.
I remember reading a story about Bob, how Peter and Bunny used to tease him in growing up, the red boy, and so he grew up with his brethren teasing him about his complexion. And it's the sort of thing that I kind of went through because I'm of a lighter complexion. What a white man not doing it, or what a red man doing it. Bob was walking through the playground with his guitar. It was as though his eyes met mine, and he just looked at me and he said, "Menor, man, menor." Just as if to see that he could identify with what I was about. That's what I got from it, basically, is that he was feeling what I was feeling.
Coming to Britain would have been a big deal for Bob Marley in terms of identity. Who is he? And I think in many ways he was working through what was a very complex relationship that goes all the way back to his dad being mixed race in Jamaica, growing up in a Jamaican community.
Nestor Robert Marley was born in 1945 in the rural St. Anne district of Jamaica. The island was still feeling the devastating effects of centuries of British colonial rule. Marley's childhood was spent in poverty, and he had little contact with his father, a naval officer who worked for the British government.
Bob's father, Norval Marley, is a white Jamaican. He was what's known as a busher, which means an estate overseer. And he's in his early 60s. Bob's mum, Sadella, is 18. But, you know, they have a relationship of sorts. And she becomes pregnant. He does, in fact, marry her. But he develops a hernia. And riding on horseback around the estate, he claims, is impossible. So he leaves her and moves back to Kingston.
It's no secret that Bob took a lot of flack for being red-skinned, light-skinned, yellow, whatever you want to call him. It took it a long time for him to find his feet. And I think that's probably what made him the writer and the artist that he became, because it made him strong, it made him stand toe-to-toe with those brothers and say, you know, we're not the same colour, but it's the same vibe, the same feel, the same spirit. You know what I'm saying?
The UK tour of 1972 had ended in disappointment, and the Wailers returned to Jamaica having failed to get the airplay or the bookings they had been seeking. Undeterred, Marley returned the following year with a new album and a new sound that would completely transform his career. May 73 saw the Wailers make music history with their television debut on the BBC. Come on,
baby. What you have to understand is that at that point, you know, a lot of people really didn't like reggae. Their ears weren't accustomed to it. So they had to get over that. And what was important was that they played on the Old Grey Whistle Test, and they were pretty sensational. Thank you.
do remember sat there watching, and Bob Marley came on, and I screamed. I absolutely screamed, jumping around the place, because reggae music wasn't something that the radio stations played, or it wasn't really featured in British society. So to see Bob Marley on the Old Grey Whistle Test blew my mind.
It was one of those moments that you never forget. This is a rock program. This is a reggae artist. It had never happened before. And up until that point, we haven't seen this band perform live. It's been a static image on an album sleeve. So really, really a powerful performance.
The Wailers had just signed to Island Records, owned by businessman and record producer Chris Blackwell. It was Blackwell's production on the Catch a Fire album, mixed at Island's Basin Street Studios in Notting Hill, that had introduced a rock and pop element to the Wailers' sound.
Marley was at a turning point in his career. The investment from Island Records, a lot of investment in promoting this artist like a rock star, transformed his success story. If this didn't happen through Island Records, we would not have the Bob Marley we know today, or the relationship even to reggae that we have today. Britain provided the platform to build that international career. He recognized that he could have a conversation through this medium that the UK provided. He could have a conversation with the world. And that was special, and I think that did change him.
Check out this packaging. Sort of equal to all the rock stuff that was going on at the time, you know. Right, check out the sound on this. The arrival of Catch a Fire was absolutely mind-blowing. They brought in these American session musicians that put on all these different guitar licks, these kind of keyboard sounds. We'd never heard that combination on reggae before. And whilst the purists hated it, for the young black British kids growing up in the UK that had this kind of weird duality, you know, we grew up listening to the Stones, the Beatles, the Kinks, the Who, Roxy Music, Bowie. So our ears pricked up when we heard these different influences coming in.
Catch a Fire featured several tracks inspired by Marley's experiences of living in Britain and others that seemed to resonate with his new surroundings.
It's a Pickens record shop. It was started by my dad, the late George Price. First man to sell Jamaican music in England from 1960 when he came here. Catch a Fire album, that is my absolute favourite Bob Marley album. No sun will shine in my day today, because London was gloomy and grey, concrete jungle. You know, he's not used to seeing so much brick.
Boosted by their groundbreaking appearance on the Old Grey Whistle Test, the Wailers were now gaining a wider audience outside their traditional fan base.
What do you got for me now?
So Chris Blackwell, owner of Island Records, saw the possibility of them selling to the college crowd. That's, they were the ones buying LPs by them, by the droves, you know, at the time. So they aimed them at the colleges, at the rock pubs, etc., etc.
And part of that is that they will do four nights at a club called the Speakeasy. It's right in the centre of London. And it's a kind of spectacular occasion, really, because it's kind of packed with kind of serious groovers. You know, there's like Bianca Jagger there and Steve Winwood. Brian Ferry also, Brian Eno. It's a real scene with an air of great expectation. The music just comes on. It sounds like something from the other side of the moon, really. And what they're playing is not something off Catch a Fire. It's a tune, Rastaman Chant, an old Naya Bingi tune, which is just seriously percussive. It was completely sensational.
I'd read that Bob was coming over to do his first tour of England. So I kind of decided not to go to school that day, you know, and so went to the club with a place called the Speakeasy Club. And he turned up, and I walked up to him and said, can I take your picture? And he said, yeah, man, come in. And he really took to me and said to me, he told me about the tour and said, hey, you want to come along? I said, yeah. In those days, there was no tour bus. It was a transit van. It was in the front seat. And he looked back and said, you ready, Dennis? I went, yeah. And the adventure began. I wanted to be a photographer. Nobody was encouraging me, including my family. And when I met Bob, he said, hey, you know, Dennis, you can do this, you know. Yeah, you know, you can be a big photographer, Dennis. We had a lot in common, Bob and I, in terms of I never knew my father. He never knew his father. I was a complete outsider, and you know, as he was. So I think that's what, again, drew us together, I think. And here in this shot, it's taken on a day off from the first tour in 1973. And he would always, when he had a day off, he'd go shopping, and he'd buy lots of footballs and football kits, and he basically was buying the equipment for the children in Trenchtown.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like you to give a good welcome to one of the greatest bands in the world, the Wailers.
From that first tour, the place they were playing, like a Mecca ballroom or something like that, you know, and maybe capacity 2,000, and maybe 200 people turned up. But he walked out there as if it was sold out. Nothing fazed him. Everything for him was a way forward, a challenge. He was on a mission.
As a DJ in 1973, I booked Bob Marley and the Wailers to appear at our very small club in Southampton, the Coach House Club. It was the back of the Fleming Arms. It was just by accident. I literally walked into the office of the booking agent, said, look, we have to fill some dates, do you have anything? And he did mention that there was this band called the Wailers that he knew nothing about, and could we fill the slot? We even, on the night of the gig, we had an advert in the local paper, and we misspelt their name, as in Wailers, people that go and catch whales, rather than Wailers, people that wail.
You're gonna light me up, yourself.
It was on the Sunday morning, a friend said, you guys know that the Wailers are in Southampton? You know, so what? And we were off like a shot.
Of course, the problem with this place, you look at it and you think, it's quite small, don't you?
Yeah.
But once you got inside, it was even smaller.
I remember at one point, we were so crushed up, and I lift one foot up, put it back down, I was standing on someone else. Hear what you gonna do, you rock so
like you never did before. If so, you did so, did through my door. You come so, you come so. Oh, yeah. The atmosphere was just electric.
Yeah, but that's
absolutely electric.
I said they were mesmerised, including myself.
Yeah, and I used that same word as well. It was mesmerising. It was almost as if they'd pumped some ganja into the air conditioning and got everybody high.
Oh, yes. He's a prophet, right? He's a prophet. You listen to any of Marley's song, and if you're not influencing, something is wrong with you.
Marley's presence resonated with the condition, particularly of young black people in Southampton, because they were told for so long they're not good enough, they can't get jobs. They were sent to schools that were supposed to be for people who were deficient in some way or the other. And they saw that the kind of jobs their parents did, as good as they may have been, they wanted to do better. Yeah, we're sick and tired of your ism, schism, game, dynamo to heaven in Jesus' name. We know and we understand. I'm actually a product of the Windrush generation. A lot of our parents had kind of denied their culture to try and assimilate. They tried to anglicise themselves, which obviously didn't work. And, you know, we're growing up teenage kids, we're seeing that our parents are basically being screwed. And that's what Bob did at that moment in time. He lifted the black youth of this country. You know, we're being informed by what's going on in America with the whole civil rights thing. So we're pissed off and angry. And Bob gave that a soundtrack.
One of the things that I remember when I first met Bob, and we'd be talking at that Speakeasy Club, you know, he said to me later, you know, Dench, you have to remember that you're an exotic tropical plant that's been uprooted and replanted on the concrete soil. So you have to be very strong to push through in that way.
From Teesside to Lancaster, Bristol to Birmingham, Marley's message of rebellion and empowerment was spreading across Britain. The next leg of their tour took them to the USA before returning to Britain towards the end of 73 to promote their new album, Burning. But life was far from happy in the Wailers' camp.
It was in the winter, and I remember one morning they woke up, they wanted to play football. And this, after like days of arguing about the cold and everything, and one morning they woke up and they wanted to play football and open the gate, and what up? So I said, it's snow. We mean snow. I said, you know, snow. And then Peter Tosh said, look, sign from Babylon, we have to leave Babylon now. But anyway, they said, yeah, man, we'll have to leave Babylon. Them tour, you know, and there was this argument between, you know, and so the tour collapsed. And they went back.
But despite this setback, Marley's popularity was seen on the rise, helped by Eric Clapton's global hit with a cover of The Wailers, I Shot the Sheriff.
It was an important crossover period. It moves the idea of Bob Marley from being an underground artist to just the potential of a major artist now, a major touring artist within a rock context.
By the time Marley returned to Britain with a new lineup in 1975, days of playing pubs and clubs were long behind him. And once again, Britain was to provide the stage for a major turning point in his career. The Natty Dread tour kicked off with two dates at London's Lyceum Ballroom.
There were so many people outside, people trying to climb on the roof, trying to get in. Thousands outside, and inside it was packed with the capacity.
Very, very hot summer night. You know, it's thick with ganja and hash smoke. It's about 50-50 black and white people. Felt something had shifted in the culture.
All the way from Trenchtown, Jamaica, Bob Marley, the Wailers, come on!
I remember when he walked out and I looked at him, I could see him looking at me in some ways and looking at the audience and say, and then tick, 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 boom. And then that bass kicked in and it was like, and it was like, yes.
The music that we loved, there we were seeing it performed in a way that we hadn't seen it performed before. It was just a magical night.
One good thing about music,
reggae had arrived.
Alongside Marley on stage were three female singers who had helped transform his sound. His wife Rita, Judy Moet, and Marcia Griffiths, known collectively as the i3s.
It was like doors were just open to this music and to this man. It's like he just blew the roof off with positive vibration and some positive reggae music.
No Woman to Cry was a very, very special song. It touched a nerve in everybody.
When that song started, oh my goodness, it was overwhelming.
As a consequence, the No Woman, No Cry live single is released and becomes Bob's first UK hit. The whole country knows who Bob Marley is now.
Bob at the Lyceum was like a religious experience. I mean, I came out of that gig a changed man, empowered, informed, and inspired.
I mean, for a lot of people, it was kind of seeing the Messiah.
The Lyceum concerts propelled Bob Marley into the musical mainstream. Followed a year later by his first UK top 10 album and another sellout tour.
Bob Marley had a concert coming up in Hammersmith, West London. I'd bought a ticket. And would you believe it, on the day of the actual concert, I lost my ticket. I had it in my pencil case all those months and I lost it on the actual day. So I started crying. This rasta guy said, why are you crying? You're really crying. I said, I've had this ticket for so many months and now the concert's here, I've lost it. And he said, stay there. Anyway, we stayed there. He came out, he gave me like 5-6 tickets. So I was able to give all my friends a ticket. So I said, oh, we're coming with you. So after that concert, they were blown away.
Yeah, that was it.
they were blown away. They were blown away by the concert. After the concert, we stayed behind and we were just hanging around as friends, just chatting about it. Then the same guy who gave me the tickets for the concert come up to us and said, ah, my name's Mikey. He said, I'm the cook for Bob Marley. We said, no way. And he said, this is where he's staying. So he was staying in Harrington Gardens.
Yeah.
So we bunked off school and we went. And I've never forgotten it. The first time I saw Bob, he was sitting down at a dinner table. He had a yellow beret on and he was eating his dinner and I went, oh, I must be dreaming. He went, yeah, all right. But every time we went, Bob would engage with us and talk to us. Like his sisters, I think.
Yeah, like young sisters.
Little sisters, yeah.
And they used to call us the Three Musketeers.
They used to call us the Three Musketeers. And because I was getting into the Rasta scene, and I did want to lock my hair, and I did sometimes wrap my hair. My dad wasn't happy, I'm not going to lie. And then I remember putting a picture of Haile Selassie up in my bedroom wall, and my dad said, you take that down, otherwise I'm getting you out.
You've got to understand that, in a strange way, Bob legitimised Rastafari. Because pre-Bob, for my parents' generation, it was a strict no-no. I mean, when I grew my dreadlocks, my parents kicked me out, didn't speak to me for 4 years.
Rastafari at that time was still seen as a sort of a cult, I suppose, in some ways. It was never really taken seriously. But I think from the success of Bob, the movement grew, and a lot of people started taking it seriously.
In between recording and performing in the UK, Bob Marley made a number of low-key trips to Rastafarian meeting places.
There are HQs in the 12 tribes of Israel, and there's different individual houses across the country that people would go. So if you were a Rasta and needed somewhere to stay, you would head for the headquarters, and you'd be fed, you'd be looked after, and you'd be welcomed. Bob Marley, he's a 12 tribes member, and he visited one of the meetings in Manchester, and that I got to see him there. And he came into the meeting and he said, I am here to worship just like everybody else, and you know, and celebrate with everyone else. And it was just like he was just one of us.
Marley even performed secret gigs as part of his visits.
His music was an education, so a lot of us didn't have the access to the books. Like now, we've got the internet, you can research anything. He was like our internet. Through music, we got educated and we learned about ourselves and had a sense of pride in who we were.
After spending the first half of 1976 touring Europe and North America, Bob Marley returned to Jamaica. His homeland had been plagued by unrest ever since gaining independence in 1962, and Marley now found himself at the centre of the political turmoil.
Jamaica is in a state of civil war. There's the People's National Party, the left-leaning party, you know, led by the Prime Minister, Michael Manley, the Jamaica Labour Party, the JLP, led by Edward Seaga. Bob Marley is called to Michael Manley's office, who asks him, as a symbol of national unity, if he'll play a concert called the Smile Jamaica Concert.
I begged Bob not to do that concert. He was never affiliated with any part of politics. But because of his innocence, he decided that he would do the concert. Tension was so strong.
Bob becomes seen as interlinked with Manley. And on December the 3rd, 1976, a group of gunmen break into his headquarters at 56 Hope Road, 7:30 in the evening. And suddenly, shots are whizzing around him. One of the bullets whizzes past Bob's chest and lodges in his arm.
He could never believe that anyone would think of doing such a thing to him. That shooting was devastating to him.
After that, Bob comes up to London. By the middle of January, they're working on the record, which becomes known as Exodus, because it's like the biblical journey. You know, it is his Exodus.
Back to England, because this is where everything all happened. Everything started right here in England. He wasn't running away, and he came here to rejuvenate and to think, to clear his head, and started writing songs.
Bob in London is removed from the pressures of the sort of uptown ghetto life. He's living in Oakley Street in Chelsea.
Oakley Street was round the corner from a shop I was running called Acme Attractions. And he'd come and get me to help take care of him, let's put it that way. So, for 77, I sold Bob weed. I was not a dealer, but it was a way to get through his front door. And it's like a Rasta ganja camp. You know, he's got his cooks in there, cooking his Ital food. And he basically created a little Jamaica within Oakley Street, which was quite a weird thing.
Every time I come to England, there are so many memories of we walking, Sister Rita and Sister Judy and myself. We look forward to getting shish kebab. This was our second home.
I think maybe he stayed in Oakley Street because just across the road, across the bridge actually, was Battersea Park, and Bob was into his football.
Bob Marley was very skilled on the football, very quick movements, and I think if Bob Marley didn't come as a great reggae artist and wanted us to play football, I think he would get into one of the big football teams here in England. He was that skillful.
You couldn't get the ball off him. You know, it was not that we were trying to respect him, really, but he just moved too quick.
Bob loved not just playing football, but he loved watching football, and becomes a fan of Tottenham Hotspurs because of the Argentinian player Ozzy Ardiles.
But it wasn't just football that was keeping Marley busy during his free time in London.
And he was a ladies' man as well. I remember I went to Carnival one time and he sends me to get him some weed. When I come back, he's trying to pull my girlfriend at the time. You know, yeah, a real ladies' man.
Bob had immediately been joined by Cindy Breakspear, his girlfriend, this by now Miss World. He'd been after her for about 3 years. And in fact, the song Waiting in Vain, supposedly about her. But she now is his girlfriend.
The summer of 77 saw millions of people hold street parties in celebration of the Queen's Silver Jubilee. But not everyone in Britain was joining in.
I mean, in 1977, punk rock was exploding all over the UK.
It was total anarchy. They just wanted to tear everything down.
Over the last 12 months, punk rock has become almost a battle cry in British society. For many people, it's a bigger threat to our way of life than Russian communism or hyperinflation, and it certainly generates more popular excitement than either of those.
I'd gone around to Oakley Street to get some money he owed me. And I'm wearing my punk rock gear, you know, I'm wearing bondage trousers. And I walk in to get this money off Bob, and he looks at me and he's like, Dunlitz, you look like one of them nasty blood clot punk... Oh, I'll do it in English. Dunlitz, you look like a nasty punk rocker, is what he said. And I took great offence to this. I'm like, Bob, they're like-minded rebels. You know, there's something going on here, Bob, you're wrong. And eventually he came to see that there was some kind of connection, maybe not musically, but certainly in spirit and attitude. So Bob wrote this particular tune in the wake of the whole punk rock explosion.
Party.
You can actually name-check some of the bands, like The Clash, The Damned, and The Jam are actually mentioned in the song.
When The Clash play their White Riot tour, Bob Marley is in the wings at the Rainbow Show, watching them. And his presence in London is very much part of what becomes known as, you know, the reggae punk fusion.
This is a major change in British culture. We can see a direct relationship between the influence of Bob Marley at that point and reggae on the music that then followed in terms of white British youth. We have The Beat, Madness, The Specials, artists even like Police that were once punk, all responding to reggae in their own way and the influence of Bob Marley. It's a key component in the soundtrack to multiculturalism. It still resonates today.
With Marley at the peak of his creative powers, he embarked on a European tour in support of the Exodus album. But things took an unexpected turn when he suffered an injury playing football.
In Paris, on I think it's May the 10th, you know, he's playing a game, it was on AstroTurf, in the shadow of the Eiffel Tower, against a team of kind of media people. And one of them stands on his toe.
Took the nail out of his big toe, and it wouldn't heal. And it started from there.
This is the beginning of a big problem. When he does Four Nights at the Rainbow, which are sensational shows, but with incredibly heavy security. But one of those nights, he comes off stage, takes his boot off, and the boot's full of blood.
The Rainbow Theatre shows were cut short, and the rest of the tour cancelled. A biopsy revealed why the toe wouldn't heal, a rare form of skin cancer.
There's denial, absolute denial that Bob had cancer. Information about just how ill he was difficult to ascertain. News footage was curtailed. Any photographs of him being ill were removed. And so it became word of mouth. It became almost gossip.
The cancer spread, and on the 13th of July 1980, Bob Marley would play his last ever show in Great Britain at New Bingley Hall in Stafford.
I'd like to ask you now about how you find your relationship with the British audience.
Yeah, you know, it was really a good feeling. England's a place, man. You know, it must be happening in England.
What must be happening?
The music. If the people in England don't like it, and plenty of people are going to like it, I'll choose that.
The last time I met him was in London. He was very subdued, and he wasn't his usual vibey self, springy self, electric self. Bob was just full of electricity, you know, he was just a live wire, and it wasn't there in that photo. And then eventually, you know, he picked up the guitar and started playing a song. I didn't really know what it was, but it turned out it was a redemption song. I think he was probably one of the first person to hear it. Sad, very, very sad song, and of course it has very deep meaning to for me.
Old pirates, yes, they rob I, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I,
from the bottomless pit. But my
Bob Marley was no ordinary pop singer. He was just 36 when he died of cancer. By the
end of the it was in the morning early and suddenly it was newsflash. Bob Marley had died. I broke down in tears. I just knew that it was over, you know, it was over.
Redemption songs. Redemption songs.
It's like losing one of your family members, yeah. It was.
Yeah. I miss him so much, and we all do, and every day he's always in my mind and my heart. Not one day goes past without me thinking of him.
Songs of freedom.
Let's get together to fight this holy Armageddon. When the men come, there will be no doom. Have pity on those whose chances grow slimmer. There ain't no hiding place from the Father of creation singing.
I think what Bob brought to Britain, I think he brought acceptance. Well, he helped to bring acceptance through music. And I will feel all right. Say it. Let's get
together and feel all right. Whoa, 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 whoa. Bob's early life would have been totally dominated by British colonialism. And he would have seen the negative sides of all of that. And yet he comes here with love and a wicked bass line and uses his culture to readjust all those injustices. Bob came here to heal the nation.
The message that he was giving whilst he was here physically is still here. Spiritually.
Bob Marley definitely changed Britain. That message of unity and love. I think we need his music more now than ever. Let's get together and
feel all right. One more thing. I always got from him that he knew he was going to make it, no matter how, where, when, but he was going to make it. And he instilled that in me. But if you've got enough conviction, enough belief in yourself, you will make it.
Let's get together and feel all right. Amen.
Bob Marley and the Wailers' Old Grey Whistle Test performance of Stir It Up in full. One of the reggae classics from the archives in Sounds of the 70s, next.